So several people have asked me why I decided to do my cross-country bike trip from the East Coast to the West Coast. So I thought I'd spend a few minutes just explaining my rationale as to why I made that decision. The number one reason, by far, that I decided to go from East to West is because of the sun. I intend to get an early start each day on this cross-country trip for a few reasons. First, I like just getting going as early as possible. I get up and I've got all my energy, but it's also usually the coolest part of the day, so why not take advantage of riding in the cool weather? Typically, the morning hours are the calmest winds of the day, so the winds don't really kick up until the heat of the day and you start getting geothermal action. So I just like getting out in the morning. So if I was riding from west to east, that would mean every morning there'd be sun glare in my eyes as I get going. And I know if I'm riding along experiencing sun glare, that means that the drivers behind me are experiencing the same sun glare and they probably can't see me. And the most important part about riding a bicycle in traffic is safety. And I just feel that the safest way to do a cross-country trip, especially with me wanting to get out earlier in the morning as possible, is to go from east to west and have the sun each morning at my back. So the second reason that I decided to go from east to west has to do with the Rocky Mountains. I just feel that having 40, 50 days of riding under my belt before I get to the Rocky Mountains is going to be a tremendous advantage. I'm just going to be first in better condition, probably have lost some weight, I hope. But secondly, I feel like I'll be in a better rhythm, a rhythm of riding each day, of sleeping each night, of being able to manage water and food intake, because as you get out west, settlements and services get further and further apart, and just having all of that experience behind me before I get out west, I just feel like is a good idea. The other thing is I look forward to experiencing the Rocky Mountains the same way that the early settlers did, maybe in their wagon trains. As you come across the horizon out in the Great Plains and you start to see those peaks peak up over the horizon, and I'm sure on a bicycle it's going to be for 2 or 3 days, those mountains are just going to keep getting closer and closer, and I'm just looking forward to that experience. And that leads me to the third reason that I've decided to go from east to west, which is I want to experience the country in the direction that it was settled by English or European settlers. Starting out in Virginia, where Jamestown was founded, and Williamsburg, and all the colonial period and the Revolutionary War. And then there's the plantation era and the Civil War. And then you start to move out west into the Ohio Valley, where the first settlers started to move west. And then you've got the Lewis and Clark expedition through Missouri and beyond, and the wagon trains that went out west. And I just feel that it's going to be very interesting to experience the country in that same direction that the flow went in. The last subject I want to touch on is what almost everybody brings up when I talk about I'm going from east to west, and that's the wind. I can't believe how many people have said, oh, but the prevailing wind is from the west, you know, so you're going to have a headwind the whole way you're going across the country. Well, that's just absurd. Well, yes, it is true that in this part of North America, the jet stream, or the prevailing winds, are from west to east. But these winds are at an elevation of like 30 to 50,000 feet. and they move the weather patterns from west to east. I have no intention on this bike trip to be anywhere close to 30,000 feet above the earth. The only way I can envisioning that happening is if for some reason I'm not able to finish the trip and I have to fly home for some reason, well then I'll be in an airplane and that'll be at 30,000 feet. Surface winds are primarily affected by a couple things: weather patterns and the geography of the area. And here in North America, or the Northern Hemisphere, when there's a high pressure area, the winds blow around the high pressure in a clockwise direction, and if there's a low pressure, they blow in a counterclockwise area. And that is primarily the biggest thing that affects surface winds, you know, as you're out there moving around the earth. As many people know, these things kind of randomly happen, the weather patterns kind of randomly happen, and yes, these high and low pressure zones follow the jet stream across the country, but if you're at the top or at the north end of a low pressure zone, the wind is going to be coming from the east. And yes, if you're at the north end of a high pressure zone, then the wind is going to be coming from the west. But it's completely random based on the weather patterns and the geography of the area. So let's look at some of the data really quick. So this is a wind rose, which is the federal government keeps a record of winds and directions in major cities across the United States. And here's the first city that I plan to go through, Richmond, Virginia. And what this wind rose shows is the probability of the direction that the wind will be blowing from. So the first thing that we can see on this is that there's a probability that the wind could be coming from any direction any day. But the highest probability in Richmond is that it might be coming from the south or the southwest. If we jump further across the country to Columbus, Ohio, again, the wind could be coming from any direction. It's not prevailing from the west. In fact, in Columbus, the highest probability, again, is it probably would be coming from the south or even a little bit to the southwest. Here's Columbia, Missouri. Again, a very strong affinity to the south, or in this case, maybe even the southeast, but not a prevailing wind from the west. Now here is Rock Springs, Wyoming. Now I'm not saying that there aren't any places in the country that the wind comes from the west a lot. I mean, look at this wind rose. The probability that the wind would come from the west in Rock Springs, Wyoming is very high. And that's just something that happens. But again, these wind rows show that there's a possibility that the wind could be coming from any direction on any given day. And then here's Portland, Oregon, which is probably the last major city that I'll go through on this trip. And again, you know, the highest probability might be from the northwest. I just wanted to show all this information because every time I talk to somebody about I'm going from east to west, they bring up that the prevailing winds are from the west, I'm going to have a headwind every day as I go across the country, and wouldn't it be great to have a tailwind every day? But that's not the case at all. The winds are very erratic, and the winds can blow from any direction on any given day, depending on the weather patterns. So anyway, I hope this answered your questions about why I've decided to go from east to west on my cross-country trip. Thanks, and wish me luck.